these boys working too well together. A little bit of nice, good, fast downhill for the moment. But as we all know, downhill is followed by uphill.
Well, if these riders were to survive to the finish, I'd like to put my money on to George Hincapie, but he's done so much work in this breakaway, and Matty Wilson and Jason McCartney have had a pretty easy ride for around about 4.5 hours of the bike race this afternoon, so it's a difficult one to predict. I would have to think that they will probably get caught down towards the running, because we're going to have a race between Leipheimer, Michael Rogers and Dave Zabriskie on the final climbs up to the finish. That is not a very good group, but it's a lot, not a very big group, I should say. This is Tony Martin on the front of there, doing a big chunk of pace making. Zabriskie may well be a guy to have a little move, because despite the fact that this climbs up quite a lot to over 7,000 feet in altitude, the run-in towards the finish is actually fairly flat. Now, if Dave Zabriskie can get into his time-trialing position with the power that he showed yesterday on the way into Bakersfield, then he could create a big surprise and be the man to go to a solo victory.
Just looking down the line there now, there seems to be, for the moment, a little bit of regular racing being done again now. 1:25 the gap, and still plenty of time to reel in those riders up front. And we're just looking at the clock. I couldn't quite read what he was. 50 kilometres now, I think it says on there at the moment. 36 and a half kilometres still to go.
Andy Schleck coming to the back. He's going to try and take an easy ride. He tried this afternoon to get himself into the winning move, but I think the legs are just not the legs that we expect from Andy Schleck in the month of July. Big work being done by HTC, but you know, despite the fact that Radio Shack are down to three men, there are a lot of riders in this group from Garmin Transitions, and they, I think, Phil, will try something themselves on the running towards the finish.
The big stallion there on the right, chipped out of wood. As we're looking at a minute 30, so these boys now, rid of everybody who they might reckon were passengers, are getting on with the job in hand. Fulsang comes back now into the main field as well. Can he hang on like Andy seems to be doing without trouble? Just see Andy off to the far right of our picture, riding at the back.
Well, Phil, just a few moments ago, I thought that those guys were almost certainly going to get caught. But now that Matty Wilson has started to put his back into the possible success of this breakaway, you've got Jason McCartney riding as well. Hincapie will do what he can to keep the organization in the front end of this group. These guys are now looking as if they've got an outside chance of surviving.
Just past the Giant Owl's Lodge. Big Bear Lake, 17 miles, remember, because we're in the California here. Big Bear Lake itself, it's a bit further, to, I think, to where we're actually finishing the race. We'll see the lake, though, 35.7 kilometres still to race. A little few tips coming from Hincapie's team car, because it's looking good. They're moving it out just a few seconds. That's a good sign right now, a minute 30. Hincapie no longer likely to become the leader of this race, so the wanted poster is off the trees just for the moment for him. And that the infighting will begin again back there. Jason McCartney wants a word of advice now from his team manager, Johan Bruneel, telling what's going on out there and at the back of the race.
Yes, a little bit indecisive, those two riders from Garmin Transitions and Radio Shack as to just exactly what they're supposed to do. They should be a lot stronger than Hincapie, who's put a lot of effort into the success of this breakaway, so theoretically they're not a danger to their own teammates, but they have to try and figure out what is the tactic of the team at this point. Is it to try and win the bike race overall, or is it to try and look for individual glory on a single stage? That's Horner there on the right-hand side in the red jersey of Radio Shack and the yellow shoes. Behind him, bigger rider Heijerdahl. Garmin are looking very strong.
Another 5 seconds added on. A minute 35 now, so this isn't too bad for George Hincapie, Jason McCartney and Matt Wilson. As we again carry on, we're in the middle of the West here now. This is cowboy country here. And this is the group. Andy Schleck has got to the back. He's been joined by Jakob Fulsang, who was in the break. He's come to the back of the chase group as well. There's the 17-mile Big Bear Lake sign. They know they're not far from home now, and the gap is a minute 35.
Well, it's gone up a little bit. I wonder, I'd like to be a fly on the wall in the team car of Radio Shack and Garmin Transitions, trying to figure out, do they try and get themselves an individual victory here this afternoon, or are they going to take their riders back to try and look after Levi Leipheimer and to look after Dave Zabriskie, because this is a very instrumental stage. It seems, though, that the order has come for them to participate with George Hincapie, and that's reflected in the fact that the time gap has moved up from 120 back up to 140.
It's going 5 seconds at a time. If we get over 2 minutes, then the message will go out to Matt Wilson to stop working, because then he would damage the possible lead tonight of Dave Zabriskie, who's equal on time with the leader, Mike Rogers. And so they couldn't take George and risk that. But at the moment, combination's good for the breakaway. Three strong men, and the chance here now they've got rid of the other riders. There's eight of them originally, there's only three left, and 140 is the gap. Slight downhill just again here for the field as Tony Martin continues to freewheel for HTC Columbia, and everybody content to follow, including the principal actors, Rogers, Zabriskie, Leipheimer, and Peter Sagan.
Yeah, those are the guys, those are the big names in the top four places in the overall classification, and they're hoping to make sure that they keep that. But there has to be a showdown on this big mountain stage. There's been almost 4,000 metres of climbing through this stage, which runs out at 218 kilometres of racing at the end of the day, and there will be some sore legs, and these guys have got to come out tomorrow and perform in a great individual time trial around the streets of Los Angeles. HTC Columbia have been under a lot of pressure this afternoon just to keep that gap down.
Well, it's worked so far. They've seen Radio Shack also try to keep it together. They've lost all of their players now, except their principal actors, Brekovich, Horner and Levi Leipheimer, but they've got the advantages of McCartney up here in Radio Shack colours as well in the break. Sadly, Lance Armstrong now having to watch this on television today, crashing out so heavily yesterday. We wish him well, certainly, and just hope he can get his season back on track for the Tour de France, but he had eight stitches in that rather ugly-looking wound just below his left eye yesterday. A massive pile-up. His teammate, Chechu Rubiera, stripped of all of his skin, got back to the race and is still in it, but he's not in this select bunch right now.
Well, looking here at Jason McCartney, Phil, a former winner of a stage in the Vuelta a España back in 2007, but last year the winner of the King of the Mountains competition here at the Amgen Tour of California. Here he'd be looking to try and win the big stage, and this definitely is the big stage of the Amgen Tour of California, one that everybody's been talking about, a place where the race could not have gone if it was still held in the month of February.
Well, they're doing a very, very good piece of riding here now. The riders on Garmin transitions there. I think Horner, you know, sees the camera come up and he turns the smile on.
Maybe that's what he's doing. Jani Brekovich just a little bit further back. Tony Martin has been a solid performer for HTC Columbia here this afternoon. He's ridden his own little cavalry on the front of the main field, not even thinking about his own performances. A guy who, let's not forget, last year, Phil, for in fact, was the wearer of the white jersey as best young rider for a long, long time in the Tour de France.
Indeed, indeed. Now he's a brilliant super domestique today.
But once it comes down to the grippy part of the course, Mick Rogers has got to assume the responsibility of him on his own and start performing to keep himself in that Amgen leader's jersey. It is only separated by the countback of the individual places that both Michael Rogers and Dave Zabriskie have had on all of the individual stages so far. Rogers was consistently ahead of Zabriskie, so his tally was that little bit lower. But that will all be changed tomorrow when we go to the race of truth, as Mick Rogers told us when he took the overall lead, because in the race of truth, there is no hiding. You have to come and ride the whole distance on your own and try and perform as you can. Sitting in the back there, you get a chance to see still Andy Schleck having a little ride to the finish here this afternoon. I still wonder, Phil, whether or not Zabriskie's going to try something here this afternoon, because, you know, there's a lot of riders from Garmin Transitions in this squad.
I think if they do, I think it's going to come late. And although it's like onto a plateau in Big Bear Lake, it's not a flat plateau at all. They have a little rolling road. Perfect. Remember, equal on time, you only have to bridge about six lengths and you've got a second. That would be enough to put that whoever gained it last in the start order in the time trial tomorrow. Might be very, very good indeed. And this is the leading three-man group, the survivors of a breakaway which started at 7 miles or 12 kilometres into this massive stage today. Their legs have got to be aching. It just has to be. And it's not just the rolling hills, it is also the altitude they are riding at. Currently, they're just on 6,500 feet above sea level.
And sadly to tell them, they've still got to ride up to 7,500 feet before they drop down into the basin here, the plateau where Big Bear Lake is. and that's going to make it a long day in the saddle. BMC just coming up there for a quick chat now. Peter Sagan, what's this all about? Are you looking for the team car?
Yeah.
He's wearing the lime green Herbalife sprint jersey. He took the overall lead in that away from Mark Cavendish after a very good victory. This is a fantastic kid from Slovakia. He's 20 years old.
He's got a changer.
Yeah, his chain has got stuck there.
Well, there's no doubt about that. It's very, very definitely a legal mechanical, but they still will be very strict if he holds on to that car. But they fixed it anyway, so that's all good. Because this is a crucial stage of the race. So no free toes, even for a mechanical. The referees would have ordered him to stop or to let go of the car, I'm sure. But he's back in there. That's all that matters. 2 minutes is the gap. It's gone out to 2 minutes.
He's going to change his bike here. You see the mechanics getting ready there. He's undoing the quick releases on that bike. The leader's bike is always, by the way, on the right-hand side of the car when you're racing in a left-hand drive country. And on the other side of the car if you're racing in the United Kingdom or Australia, so the mechanic can get out quickly and take the leader's bike off first. He's definitely getting himself ready here for a very quick bike change. That's why you're going to see Sagan sitting at the back end of the main field. And this is looking a little bit precarious, isn't it?
Yeah, it'll be a good change, though, I hope. It'll be interesting. Stop, boys.
Well, I've got to say, I have never seen a bike change like that in my life. It worked anyway. He got the bike change done very quickly. The mechanic holding that bike, and there was no panic at all from Peter Sagan. Rather an interesting thing to see. There's obviously a problem with it. Well, the chain is still... Well, he still has that problem with his chain. He got himself back into the main field, and they managed to change that very quickly indeed. I wonder if the mechanic is going to try and fix that. Because the funny thing is, a bike rider, even though all of these bikes are identical, they're exactly the same geometry, they're measured up to exactly the same millimeter, but a bike rider has a special feeling for certain bikes. There's a little move coming here, and I would expect that was going to come from, it's again Jani Brakovic. He's looking for the move here this afternoon. They're going to throw everything at the bike race here, and now you can see HTC Colombia are dragging themselves up. Slowly but surely, that's Tommy Danielson there has decided he needs to cover that move. Danielson is also high up in the overall standings. He's in exactly the same time as Jani Brakovic. They're both at 31 seconds in arrears. Getting across the gap, HTC Colombia. There won't be any work at all there done by Tommy Danielson, but it's putting a lot of pressure now onto Mick Rogers.
So let's have a look. This is about the second or third time that Radio Shack have tried to break it up, but the boys on the other teams, the soldiers, are monitoring everything here. It's becoming quite a tactical infight, and for this reason alone, McCartney, Hincapie and Wilson up front are taking advantage. Brakovic has gone again. They're right on him. They're trying desperately now to split this leading group up.
Well, Tommy Danielson was ordered by Garmin Transitions to cover this move because they realise that he's in exactly the same time as Jani Brakovic, but this is the start and the foundations of the move by Radio Shack.
These are the cards which clever teams will play because everybody thinks Levi Leipheimer is to win for the team for the fourth year. So play your other cards who are only half a minute off the pace and they can win for the team anyway. It's got rid of Andy Schleck. He's now lost contact. It's got rid of Fulsang. He's also gone off the back. And this is a big push by Brakovic now. Very, very serious move. Tommy D is the Garmin boy on the left.
Well, this is the move now that Tony Martin, poor old Tony Martin, he's in fourth position there. He's done all of the pacemaking for his team, and he's now all of a sudden found himself at the front in the counter move, the move that could see a big change at the top end of the overall classification. And he's putting pressure here, Phil, on everybody. There's riders now starting to slip back from the front end of this race. It looks as if Tommy Peterson was one of the riders from Garmin Transition slipping back. The order has come from Dave Zabriskie sitting in third position there to pick up the pace, to pull this group back. But what he's going to do, he's going to put himself into a little bit of pressure because as soon as they make the junction, watch out for the move to come from Levi Leipheimer.
Well, it's got to. And what about Michael Rogers? He's been isolating as much as teammates are here, trying to stop this runaway train of Janis Brakovic and leaving him behind in the slipstream at the moment. Tommy Danielson there and Garmin. He used to come from Connecticut. He now lives in Durango in Colorado. Either way, he's used to this sort of weather in midsummer. He's just looking over his shoulder to see on progress, and he's back on real good form here, Tommy D, as we call him. And there'd be no sad eyes in the house if he were to take over the race lead at the expense of his teammate, Dave Zabriskie. I think there's a reaction from the field, though. They're not letting this lot go.
They are not letting them go at all. I think the other rider in there from HTC Columbia is the young kid on the block, TJ Van Garderen. And he is a rider that's been brought into this squad at a very young age. And I think he's found himself right end of the top end of the sport of professional cycling here. Tony Martin just sitting on the back. Tommy D is the man who's gone to cover the move. But look at the move. There's an attack there by one of the riders from Garmin Transitions. And I wonder if that is going to be Dave Zabriskie. No, well, it isn't.
It's not Zabriskie. But you mentioned TJ Van Garderen, Paul. He was second in the Amateur Tour de France, as we used to call it, the Tour de l'Avenir last year. Now, this is going to be, is this rider Heyerdahl is putting a move here? Looks like it is. And a quick reaction, a quick acceleration from Horner. Well, we've forgotten about the three riders up front at the moment, but during the skirmishes here, that lead of the three up front has come back to a minute 35. This is a big grimace here from a champion of this year's Spring Classics. And Horner has nailed him back, the winner of the Tour de Pays Basque this year.
Well, Horner has had a great season, so too has rider Heyerdahl. Now the aggression is starting on this big mountain stage of the Amgen Tour of California. And look at the damage at the back. Oh, Peter Stettner, he's slipping backwards here, field number 66. Second in the best young rider competition. He's being spat out of the back because of the acceleration of his own teammates.
Yes, and Peter needs to hang on here because of the presence of Peter Sagan. He might be able to get over Sagan tomorrow in the time trial. But not if he's dropped today, he won't. He'll lose too much time. So there is Stettner now in a little bit of trouble here. He'll just hope that the pressure comes off if they catch these two. So he's just got to keep eyes down and ride to the best of his ability and hope the pace slows down. Ryder Heyerdahl, there's Stettner. Ryder Heyerdahl, he's wearing the Rabobank white jersey as best young rider because the man who really owns it at the moment, Peter Sagan, he's wearing the green jersey as the Herbalife points leader, which takes priority. So well, there we see rider Heyerdahl then, just seeing what his damage is doing.
Well, those two riders, Horner and Heyerdahl, Phil, are in that group of riders on exactly the same time at 31 seconds in the rear. So it puts pressure on Mick Rogers, it puts pressure on their own teammates, Levi Leipheimer and Dave Zabriskie. But as you can see now, Team HTC Columbia are on the back foot. They've got to rally the troops, they've got to concentrate, they've got to try and pull this race back together.
Well, there's no doubt that they're riding this race for Horner to win it as far as Radio Shack are concerned, because Horner is marking rider Heyerdahl, but he's not pushing home the attack. He's gone to the front, but this is not a drive to drop the field. I think it's to regularise the pace. And rider Heyerdahl sees them coming back, and it's HTC. It's man and manner here. It's a fabulous bike race now. HTC Columbia is clawing this back in favour of the race leader, Michael Rogers. Everybody back together again, few deep breaths, and then Stettner should get back on.
Yes, but hold on, because once they slow down like that, there's very often a counter move goes straight over the top. Well, there you can see the lime green jersey, Herbalife points leader, Peter Sagan. He's got himself back into the group, and with all of that acceleration, we'd kind of forgotten that there are three riders still at the head of the race. Jason McCartney, and this is McCartney here, Matty Wilson wearing 67, George Hincapie number 71. But all of that aggression and all of those accelerations have pulled that gap now, Phil, down to just 40 seconds. Now here's another move.
One after another now, Radio Shack throwing down the gauntlet time and time again. HTC Columbia will not push home the vantage here. Garmin are coming across. The top three teams of the whole race are now marking each other. The domestics are chasing. It's like a game of football. Let's look at the numbers and chase them down. And look, something's got to give, Paul. You can't keep doing this without cracking something.
You've got to keep hammering. You've got to try and break that elastic and just dragging himself across the gap there. You can see rider Heyerdahl has seen this as a very good move. A little bit further back, there is a gap now back to the main field.
Yeah, but Heyerdahl wants somebody to come through, and they won't come through. If they won't come through, it'll concertina again. This is not what they want. They want Levi Leipheimer to come and join the fun and games.
Well, that's what the idea would be for Team Radio Shack, but that's also the move that we've seen now coming from Garmin Transitions. There's a nice little move starting to form there. It's seven riders going clear. And again, putting pressure onto the front end of the main field. So there is now a group at around about 20 seconds, and it's only 40 seconds to the main field. And all of a sudden, I think we may well see a general regrouping in this bike race.
They could, yes, I think so, because unfortunately, this counter-attack and a counter-attack has really damaged the breakaway, who are just riding at a consistently steady pace. But these boys are lifting it and then reforming and lifting again. Here we go again, and it's the Radio Shack again.
Well, this is the these are the moves that they're trying to set themselves up for the big leaders, for Chris Horner, for Levi Leipheimer, Dave Zabriskie. These guys are all trying to break the stranglehold on this massive big stage. The yellow jersey group is now 30 seconds behind the leading group of three riders. Let's not forget there are still three riders up the road, but there is nothing being held back at all here. Look at that over on the left-hand side, Rogers, Leipheimer and Dave Zabriskie.
And as they come back together again, the top teams with the two top riders, and there's another attack gone on the far side of the road.
That's Tommy Danielson, I reckon, Phil, that it is. He's got his glasses stuck up in the top there, followed there by Levi Leipheimer. Now, this is going to be dangerous. Mick Rogers has seen that immediately. Leipheimer, that's Horner, actually, in second place. Leipheimer in fourth place, and it's all together.
Yes, a good move by Tommy Danielson. This man has found his old confidence again, and he's now riding very, very well indeed.
Right, who's going to be the next man to make the move? There's the three leaders, and very shortly they will be back in the fold. Their hope for glory on this afternoon up to Big Bear Lake is not going to come to fruition, but that doesn't mean that Big George hasn't got the sprint left in his legs to try and win himself the stage at the end of the day. But shortly, for the first time since the 12th kilometre of this race, they will have a little bit of company. They're not too far away, actually, from getting to the summit of Butler Peak. And very quickly then, once they go over Butler Peak, they will drop down and they will then circumnavigate Big Bear Lake, and we'll get some magnificent views of this big ski resort.
Just saying, Paul, that these three boys now, they're in target range. There's a respite again, that we've seen the attacks and they've slowed again. This is the flat approach to Big Bear Lake that doesn't have any marking of the mountains, and they're climbing all of the time. 20 seconds the official gap, and I would say that's about right, sadly, now because as we continue on the climb up towards Big Bear Lake, it's an undulating false flat up to the finishing line in the end of the day. But Matt Wilson, George Hincapie, Jason McCartney, because of the attacks and counter-attacks, are being caught at 24 and a half kilometers ago, just 15 miles from the finish. For the first time since this race left the 7th mile or the 12th kilometre, all together.
This is Rory Sutherland now, I think, coming over the top. He's decided this is the time to make another big move for United Healthcare. And he's seen this as a chance because he knows there's going to be a matching and a marking between the big leaders, Zabriskie, Rogers and Leipheimer. So he may well be able to take the advantage from this.
Well, Rory Sutherland is on the Fly V Australia. He's on the United Healthcare team, sorry, as Paul has said. And he is... possibly an unmarked man, but not because he's an unfancied name in the big world of cycling. He is not. He is a great bike rider in his own right. Used to ride for Rabobank. More importantly, they've got to chase everybody just now. He's in the infamous 31-second group, which sits just behind the top four riders in this race.
Well, in fact, that is Mark DeMar who's gone. He's about as big.
He's fifth overall.
He's fifth overall. He's as big as Rory Sutherland. Now, this is going to put a lot of pressure onto this. He is also in that group of riders, not too far behind. He's been very aggressive. In fact, he is only at 28 seconds. A Dutch rider on the United Healthcare team presented by Maxxis, and he has got himself a very serious gap now. They're going to have to do some recalculations and not watch each other.
Well, this is the big danger. So many guys here can gain a handful of seconds and lead this race into the time trial tomorrow. And the big domestics here can't chase every single rider. Now, it's interesting to see that some of the names we've not mentioned have just sat here, watched all the moves by the big hitters, watched all the counter moves, and they're sensing now, is it time? Are they tired? I'm going to have a go. And Mark DeMeyer has ridden a very, very solid Amgen Tour. He's never finished far from the shoulders of Zabriskie or Leipheimer or Michael Rogers, and now he's playing his cards.
Well, you know what, Phil, lying in fifth place overall, he's going to create a little bit of consternation in that group. They're going to say to themselves, well, I wonder what this guy has done in the past. They don't really know very much at all about him, and they will all of a sudden have to try and figure out if he's going to be dangerous in the individual time trial. You can be almost certain that a lot of the team managers will be going through their books to try and figure out what his previous performances have been.
Well, Mark de Meyer, he's come on to the team this year. He's actually a Dutchman, and they won't know too much about him. But as he's making his move here, quite clearly this team has come on to this race very, very well prepared. A double-headed attack with Rory Sutherland as well, an Australian who also is a regular on this team. But Mark now is making, he's come over from the Rabobank squad, and he might have left a good one go here.
Well, certainly, you know, he has ridden some of the big stage races in the past. He's ridden the Giro d'Italia previously. He's ridden the Vuelta a España on a couple of occasions. In fact, the only thing I can find that he's ever won in his life was going back to 2005 when he had four wins. And he, in fact, was the overall winner of a race in the middle part of France called the Tour de Loire-Echer. So he's a pretty dangerous guy to sit back and allow to go free. And I'm sure that all of a sudden there's going to be a bit of panic coming onto the board of the main contenders in this race, because you don't let a man like that ride off the front, especially on the eve of an individual time trial.
No, although he's not got any known ability in the time trial, but you know, as the great Sean Kelly, who's now retired, once said, if you pull on a leader's jersey, then you time trial like 10 men, because it inspires you that much. Here's the counter-attack, it has to come. Is it Matt Wilson who's made the move? I can't believe he's got the legs to do that again after the breakaway.
He was covered very quickly there by Chris Horner there, Tony Martin again. Martin's doing a job of 10 men here this afternoon. It was Matty Wilson. And Ryder Heyerdahl again trying to go clear. He's looking for 31 seconds, trying to scramble across the gap is Jani Brakovic.
And that is a serious move by big Ryder Heyerdahl now. He's also full of confidence after a tremendous performance in the Flèche Wallonne Classic in April.
Wow, he's got 40 seconds advantage, Mark de Meyer here. Now it's starting to look a little bit dangerous, but he has got a long ride to go to the finish, Phil. He's got 23 kilometres. He's got to circumnavigate the whole distance of Big Bear Lake before he can actually get into the resort on the other side of the lake. They've gone over the top of the climb now, which was not categorised, but that's known in this area as Butler's Peak.
But the question is, who is going to win at Big Bear Lake? 23 kilometres left to go.
22 kilometres is around about half an hour of racing here. Now, again, we've got a serious group starting to form here. This could be the demise of Dave Zabriskie, Mick Rogers and Levi Leipheimer, because they don't want to make the move when they've got their own teammates in a move like this. And it could be a completely different rider that we've been talking about. The top three we've talked about since the very start of this race. We've talked about Zabriskie, Leipheimer, and of course in there as well we've talked about the man from, I've forgotten who I've talked about.
Well, you're talking about very well. Give me a clue.
Leipheimer, Zabriskie, and of course Mick Rogers. I forgot about.
There's, well, this Mick has been such a fantastic attacking race today, Paul. I forgive you, because these guys are throwing everything at one another today, countering the moves. Something has got to give here, but boy, they know they've been in a bike race today. This has been a total free-for-all. And for the moment, Mark de Meyer is playing an ace card here, because can he time trial tomorrow? We don't know. But who cares? If he gets the yellow jersey tonight, he'll have played a huge part, because don't forget that his team is basically a team that rides only here in the United States. For them, it is a massive, massive piece of publicity for United Healthcare. Now, a little bit of a reorganization, and the interesting Cervelo rider in this break is Oscar Pujol. He's the Spanish rider on the Cervelo team. He's the man in black in the center. They don't know who to chase next now.
Well, they're about to get pulled back into the fold, but more importantly, look at the time gap, because it's 45 seconds to the United Healthcare rider in front, and he's now starting to look like a serious contender to the overall lead of Mick Rogers and Dave Zabriskie.
Well, these four trying to get on with their hand, but, you know, we're talking of two riders on the same time overall, Rogers and Zabriskie, while the others are only seconds behind. Anybody that makes the decisive move from this group could be the next leader of the tour. And that leaves us with an incredible weekend in prospects. It might open up in the time trial tomorrow, and then again, it might not, because the boys at the head of the classification are such good time trial riders. It might be showdown around Thousand Oaks on the final day of racing. Look at this. They're all back together.
That is going to be a very difficult final stage as well, because it's a circuit race with a number of climbs each lap. So this is Marc Démare. He's the leader now. He's got a 30-second advantage, and he may well have thought it was all downhill to the finish, but it's a very undulating final 20 kilometers of racing here as he puts his back into this, trying to not only get himself the stage victory, but pull himself that little bit higher in the overall classification. A man who started in fifth place overall, looking for just 28 seconds. Tommy D now has been put onto the defensive, but look at this again. Oh. Accelerations are coming thick and fast from everybody.
Well, the art of being a great stage race bicycle rider is to be able to attack, recover and attack. And they're demonstrating that today. These boys are taking a few deep breaths and they're going again until they finally get it right. 30 seconds, Marc Démare, and I'm hearing he's approaching the 20 kilometer. Oh, there it is, the 20 kilometer sign. 12 miles to go to the finish. That's going to give him a lift.
That will give him a lift. He will all of a sudden do the magical calculation in his mind that he knows that's going to take probably inside of 30 minutes to get himself to the finish, and he will be spurred on by that as he looks across to the mountain cap, the snow-capped mountains there, right in the very heart here of the San Bernardino range.
There is a little bit of snow around the finishing area, but nothing to talk of, and you may not even notice it as we come into the finishing line, but it's still around to evidence winter leaving us as they continue to counter the moves here.
Matty Wilson going again. I'm not quite sure why he's going again like this, unless he's just trying to think about getting himself a stage victory or pulling the sting out of the tail of the other riders, like the riders from HTC Colombia, who now are really pretty much on the defensive. But what an attacking race this has been.
Well, they're trying to reach across the gap here because they've got to force reactions from the other riders here. Michael Rogers is just hoping all of these skirmishes just get nullified. He's riding the third wheel here. Zabriskie is still with him. But you can only make so many moves before you crack yourself. So they've got to worry now, because although there's no more actual prizes on these mountains, no categorized climbs, it is really tough all the way to the finish.
It certainly is. Hats off for Tony Martin. To me, he's got to be the man of the match here this afternoon for HTC Colombia, because he has ridden an individual time trial for the majority of this very difficult stage. Slowly but surely, he's pulling himself back to the slipstream of Matty Wilson. And the gap now is coming down to around about 15 seconds to Marc Démare, but I'm sure he will have rocked the foundations of a few riders' beliefs that they can win this bike race, especially with the fact that they got a time check of 50 seconds after he'd been away for about a kilometre or so. There's Matty, and he's just hovering off the front end of the main field. This has been a long, hard stage, and these guys have got to come out tomorrow and do exactly the same thing again, but they have to do it on their own over a 33-kilometre individual time trial around the very, very streets of Los Angeles in the shadows of the great Beverly Hills and Hollywood. He's suffering a little bit now. He never finished high up in races like the Giro d'Italia or the Vuelta a España, finishing in around about 50th place in both of those. But now what he's trying to do is steal a final stage victory for his team, United Healthcare. At least nobody will forget that the United Healthcare team have been in the Amgen Tour of California. There's Matty Wilson just around the corner. So we're looking at around about a 20 to 25 second advantage here for the lone leader. 20 seconds over Matt, and probably a little bit further back, 5 seconds further back for the front end of the main field. So there you can see it's still.
Well, the sun is high in the sky now, that is for sure, as we come to 3:30 in the afternoon here in. Well, the sun is high in the sky now, that is for sure, as we come to 3:30 in the afternoon here in Southern California. We're way up, we're very close to the sun right now, approaching circa 7,000 feet above sea level. Just 18 kilometers to go, about 11 miles left to race, Paul. and it's still wide open. Any one of 20 riders could be the leader tonight.
No, they certainly could. It's very close indeed, and it's going to be a massive racing weekend, I have to say, with an individual time trial around Los Angeles and then a mountainous circuit race around Thousand Oaks on Sunday. This race, I think, Phil, could absolutely go right down to the line.
Well, the latest move has come from Mark Damar, an ex-Rabobank man who's trying to nip away from his former team and fly the flag for United Healthcare because he's come across the American squad now. He made his move 24 kilometres from home. Here we are, 18 kilometres from home. He's been out front for a quarter of the remaining distance. Can he hang on? He's looking very, very strong, this rider, doing what he does well. And that's ride alone fast. When he's free of the peloton. He started out, don't forget, today about 28 seconds off the yellow jersey. He gets a small win bonus. What is it, 10 seconds, I think it is, Paul, isn't it?
10 seconds for first place to cross the right of the line at 6 seconds and 4 seconds. That's something that they have in a lot of the professional bike races around the world where you can actually win time back, if you like. That's probably the best way to try and explain it. If you cross the line in first place, you're given a 10-second bonus, and that's taken off your aggregate overall time. And that's extremely important. And the level that these races are raced off at, sometimes they can be decided by these time bonuses out on the route.
Well, at this moment in time, with a 30-second advantage, he is the new leader of the Amgen Tour of California, if he were to cross the finishing line right now, and he wouldn't need any bonus time to do it. And that would have been will be a big turnaround if that happens, because we haven't really mentioned this rider. We've just noted him every day on the overall classification, never moving from that fifth place in the race, which means he's always finished every day alongside the leaders of this tour. And look at this now. Matthew Wilson has crossed the gap. Big effort. Well done, Matthew Wilson. Where's he finding the legs from? He's been in the break all day.
Well, let's not forget he's been a former Aussie national champion. He's a great competitor. He's bridged the gap here now up to Mark Damar. Interesting thing about Mark Damar, Phil, I confused him a little bit earlier when he attacked with, of course, Rory Sutherland, but they were actually very good mates, because way back in 2004, Rory Sutherland and Mark Damar were on exactly the same Rabobank development squad, and that's where they learned to know each other. And it was once that Mark Damar had these bad problems, was with injury last year, that Rory Sutherland said to United Healthcare, guys, why don't you bring this guy across? He's had a nasty season last year, but I do know that he's got great talent, and he's showing us that this afternoon.
Well, you got a glimpse there of Big Bear Lake, and there's also a great story about Matthew Wilson as well. I remember I was in Australia when he won his National Road Racing Championship in 2004. It was congratulations all round for a man who triumphed over cancer, and which is quite amazing when this race supports the charity that fights cancer. Because he started out as a cyclist, and he was suffering from Hodgkin's disease, and he underwent chemotherapy in the June of 2000. And then he gradually clawed his way back to be a great bike rider. And then the icing on the cake came in 2004 when he won the National Road Racing Championship. And now it looks like he's learning to ride like a real top bike rider. Now he's come this year to Garmin Transitions.
And bear in mind, Phil, that this guy that we're looking at in the blue shorts at the front, he was in the breakaway for almost the whole of the stage. He was in that eight-man breakaway that dominated the race from the 12th kilometer. He was pulled back into the fold, and he still had the energy to go away in another move.
30 seconds the gap there, having a big problem here now, because we have an Australian-Dutch tandem who race on American teams, these two riders. The profile for the moment is flat as we course around this lake here. There won't be any real major climbs now, but we do get ripples that could upset the rhythm. But have these two made the move that will swing the leader's yellow jersey in a direction which we never thought of, to Mark Damar?
Well, everybody was watching themselves. It was HTC were watching Garmin Transitions. Garmin Transitions were watching Radio Shack. And all of a sudden, somebody had been there just waiting for the moment to make the move. And it was Mark Damar. When he made that move, he really hit them hard. And this is a day when everybody is suffered to stay in the bike race, to keep the gaps at a reasonable level. Now, all of a sudden, is there any energy left with HTC Colombia? But what it does do is it takes away the time bonuses. And if they can pull that gap back to inside the 28-second advantage, then it will keep Mickey Rogers still at the top end of the leaderboard.
This is the beautiful scene here, the Big Bear Lake, and look at the speedboat enthusiasts charging across there, racing across to catch a glimpse of the race coming in now into town. And when you keep a tight shot on that, you think it was the Pacific Ocean, but if not, we're high in the mountains here. We go into like a bowl which the lake has formed. poses the question, just how deep is this lake? But it is certainly a place for leisure and fun now. This is an area we've never been before, and there the bike riders not getting the view we get, causing down the side of the lake.
Well, you know, this lake, Phil, it's been around for an awful long time, and the area that we're looking at around this lake was inhabited by the Serrano Indians for more than 2,000 years. But this part of the world started to become quite famous, especially during the California Gold Rush, when people started to move up into the mountains here to look for gold and to look for gold deposits. And it is an area, and you'll enjoy this, which is full of flora and fauna. And in the old days, up until the early 1900s, you could still find grizzly bears in this area around the lake.
Well, they might pay us a visit today, because we've got a gold rush of a different type today, a race for the golden jersey of the lead of the Amgen Tour of California. And as it stands now, Mark Damar will be pulling it on tonight with a gap of 35 seconds. Matty Wilson won't endanger that. The field behind are still chasing, but they're not making any progress just now. It is sitting at 35 seconds, and a couple of small bonuses for those two boys up front as well. So this is looking good just now with 12 kilometers to go.
It's locked in now. These two riders are sharing the pace together, and we could see that Matty Wilson now is looking to see whether or not he can grab a stage victory here this afternoon. And he's come up and he started working with Mark Damar, but all of a sudden he's putting his own teammate Dave Zabriskie into a little bit of difficulty, because Dave Zabriskie only had a 28 second advantage with Mick Rogers over Mark Damar at the start of the day.
Yes, well, not surprisingly, Matt Wilson is not helping the breakaway. He's got a cross to him. He'll annoy him, and he'll try to outsprint it for the first prize, if that's the case. But he's not going to help him run away from Dave Zabriskie. That would not be the job of a teammate right now. But he would try to take the win bonus off him, which would be the job of a teammate. Having said that, he might work, Paul. 11 kilometres to go, 35 seconds is the gap. As we're speeding across the waves of Big Bear Lake, as we search for the shorelines here and the group that's chasing them up towards the finishing line.
Well, it's going to be touch and go. Those are two strong riders at the front. The next banner they will see will be 10 kilometers to go and 35 seconds advantage. And still, there's no panic on the face there of Mickey Rogers. Mick knows now that he's probably going to have to bank on his individual time trialing ability tomorrow around the streets of Los Angeles. And in the past, he has been a great individual time trialist. Let's not forget, he's the current Australian national time trial champion, and he's been three times champion of the world in that discipline.
But amazingly, the first time he's ever won the national title, which is quite surprising. But anyway, they may be saying, look, how much can we give this guy up front and still beat him in the time trial tomorrow? And the answer is they don't know, because he is not a well-known cyclist on the block, and he's come across the race on an American team, and boy, he's played this ace at the minute. On the outskirts of Big Bear Lake here, and 10 kilometers to go for the riders, 35 seconds the gap. And these two boys have got a chance. There's the lake. Not everybody's watching the finish, it seems. They're all having fun on the water.
No, a big recreational area here, Phil, whether it's in the winter or whether it's in the summer. This lake actually freezes over in the winter time, and a lot of people come up here from Los Angeles, only an hour and a half away from where we are, to ski. Still locked in at 35 seconds, the advantage at inside of 10 kilometers to go. And I wonder if anybody's got the firepower to pull these two leaders back into the fold. If you're enjoying the images and the views from around this part of the world, it might be a time to remind you that originally the movie that was filmed in the 1920s, The Last of the Mohicans, was filmed in this area. And the musical, The Paint Your Wagon, was shot here in 1969. Now it's up to HTC Columbia. They've got the big men on the front here, Tony Martin, trying to keep the pressure up, trying to pull this all back together. But it's a hard day for these guys. There is the youngster on the squad there, Van Garder, and he's in second position. Hincapie just sitting on the back here. He's been in the breakaway for a long time here this afternoon. But everybody is in agony at this point.
The speed, they're going round the chicanes now. Desperate moments here in what has been an outstanding day of racing in the Amgen Tour of California. Our first visit to this sort of height will be just below 7,000 feet on the finishing line, 35 seconds the gap.
Well, I tell you what, HTC Columbia have had a very hard day in the saddle, Phil, because they have been on the front for nearly all of the 218 kilometers that this race will have been on to when we get down towards the finish line at the end. And still, Tony Martin has got a little bit of firepower left to keep the pressure going. But these two guys at the front, Matty Wilson in second position, Mark DeMar, the rider from United Healthcare, they are still swapping turns. They've put pressure on that group at the back, and they've got the ability to survive and create a change. A change that, as you said earlier, we probably never would have predicted.
Well, I can imagine Rabobank scuttling out and trying to sign him back onto the team after this performance. I've never seen him ride so well. He left the team last year. He came across to United Healthcare. This is hugely important, of course, for an American team to do well in this race. And he is working very, very hard for a golden jersey at the end of it. He's still in it at the moment. He's still the leader of this race with an advantage of 30 seconds. Don't forget a bonus of at least 6 at the finishing line if he gets second. And Wilson will do his best to beat him until the line and stop him taking too much time off his teammate, Dave Zabriskie.
Yeah, Matty Wilson is a very seasoned professional bike rider, Phil. He's been professional for 10 years now, turning professional way back in 2001. But as you said, that fight back to get himself to the top of the sport from Hodgkinson's disease was a very long fight back. But now I think he's very happy now to have got himself onto Garmin Transitions, and he feels comfortable with the team. He's looked after by Matty White, who is one of the other team managers of Garmin Transitions, and a man who brings a wealth of experience and a lot of Australians to the squad.
A lot, and they're having a great season now. But it looks as though we've got HTC Columbia. They've got two riders left here to try and guide their leader, Mick Rogers, to keep it that yellow jersey so he gets to start last 20 seconds. They're doing well. The time trial prowess of Tony Martin, bronze medalist in the World Time Trial Championships last year, albeit courtesy of Bradley Wiggins, who would have got the bronze if he hadn't thrown a tantrum and his bike over the wall. But even so, he got the bronze medal. And so as we now look at Martin working, he's got it back to 20 seconds. It now means at the moment Mark DeMar would have to win the stage for the big bonus to get yellow.
And he would only get it by a mere 2 seconds at this point, and that's the arithmetics and that's the maths that these guys put through their minds while riding along at around about 50 kilometres an hour. It's amazing the job that's being done by HTC. You see, they've not panicked at all. They've kept themselves at a fairly steady rhythm. They've slowly started to pick up the pace as they get closer to the finish, and they now realise, and they will now on the long straightaways have these guys in their sights. Well, that's what they'll be looking for. And in a few moments' time, there'll be other guys starting to come to the front, thinking about how they're going to win the stage. But I wonder if anybody in this group is going to be able to beat Peter Sagan.
Well, will it matter? I don't know. They've got to catch him up first to the finish. But if Sagan wins, he'll inch that little bit closer before the time trial tomorrow. Then we would be all eyes to who finishes in front of the other as far as Zabriskie and Rogers goes to get the yellow. That's a combination which we haven't got yet. 15 seconds the gap. 7 kilometres to go. This is close.
It's very close, and when you pull back from the helicopter like this, there's the two men that they're trying to grab. This is the front end of the main field. HTC Columbia have supported the weight of the Amgen Tour of California on their shoulders here this afternoon, and they are still doing so now as they come down to inside of 7 kilometres to go. The official time gap now is back to 10 seconds, so Mickey Rogers there in third position can breathe a sigh of relief for the moment. But he's got to watch out for Dave Zabriskie, because those two riders are on exactly the same time. They're only separated by the positions that they've finished on every individual stage so far. A very precarious position to be in. Levi Leipheimer is still in third place overall at 10 seconds. Peter Sagan, the 20-year-old rider from Slovakia and Team Liquigas, is in fourth at a mere 15 seconds. And he'll be looking to try and get win number two.
Well, as we talk, the clock ticks through 6 hours in the saddle today. And really, we are no closer knowing who is going to lead it tonight, nor indeed who is going to win this classic stage of this year's Amgen Tour of California. 12 seconds the gap. There'll be more attacks. They minute to catch these two, if they catch them. We're starting to look now for 5 kilometres to go.
12 seconds correlates to around about 120 metres at this speed in the sport of professional cycling, and that's not very far. But you know, when you've been in the saddle for almost 5 hours on a day like this, Phil, it's a long way out to try and grab those two riders, and it seems to take forever.
Well, 5.5 kilometres, just over 3 miles to the finish. It's TJ Van Garderen who's come up to the front now to try and lift the pace that little more. This is a big find and a young man for the future for this American team. Second this year in the presidential tour of Turkey. And now looking to try and drag his man Mike Rogers back into the, or not back into, but to keep for him the yellow jersey he's wearing. And as we see these two guys now out in front, desperate moments here. Not far off that 5 kilometres to go. We're dodging down this beautiful borders of the Big Bear Lake. No more hills to speak of, just a little bit of ripples. It isn't an easy run up to the line. It is sort of a main road climb in the houses up to the finish. But it is a drag, and it could prove crucial if you get your sprint wrong.
Well, Matty Wilson there throwing his bottle out, wanted to get himself as light as possible for these final 5 kilometres of racing, and it's still hovering on the 10-second advantage. HTC Columbia really, Phil, don't actually have to pull those two riders back into the field now. They can allow them to stay off the front. And if anybody else wants to win an individual stage here at the Amgen Tour of California, it's now up to them to come back and catch these two. So that's the way the race is separated. There are the two leaders just around the corner. But pretty much now you've got the riders from HTC Columbia. They've got everybody in their sights. Chris Horner's moving up to the front. He may be nurturing hopes of trying to get himself a victory this afternoon. Not far away from the front is Levi Leipheimer. Dave Zabriskie's in there too, but it's always the team of Michael Rogers of Australia, HTC Columbia, who are doing the pacemaking. Matty Wilson, quick look over his shoulder there to see and ascertain what the gap is looking like, wondering whether or not they're going to survive. He knows how quickly these things can change in this level of the sport. They're taking the right-hand turn now across the causeway, almost to the end of Big Bear Lake, and the main field have still got them in their sights. They're taking that right-hand corner. And there they can see there the two leaders are. They, as I've said, they don't have to catch them. If you want to win the stage here this afternoon, it's up to somebody else to come forward. Peter Stettner, he's in the white jersey there, the white jersey of the best young rider in this bike race. He's scrambled himself back into the leading group. He was in difficulty a couple of times on some of the earlier slopes. But again, a rider at just 20 years of age, riding one of the biggest races in his young professional career.
Well, we have seen a classic bike race today, Paul. No one has succumbed. They have thrown every punch they've had in their back pockets. And now it has been some brilliant riding by Tony Martin, TJ Van Garderen, to try and drag Mick Rogers up for another yellow jersey. But it is still touch and go.
It is touch and go. This is one of the riders just slipping back. It looked as if that
McCartney.
Was McCartney,
yeah.
From Radio Shack. He was in the break for a long time this afternoon. These two men are just wishing they would survive there, wishing away the kilometres at the moment. Matty Wilson keeps looking over his shoulders. He's trying to ascertain, are they pulling us back quickly? Are we going to survive? The gap now is down to a mere 8 seconds as they make one more turn here in Big Bear Lake, the great ski resort founded in 1952. But Tony Martin is doing the job now. He's clawing his way back to these two riders. They are wondering now, Phil, at about 2 kilometres to go, whether or not they will survive. And I don't think now that they will, unless, of course, Matty Wilson can jump away from Mark DeMar and solo his way to victory. But, you know, these guys are so close, and these professionals know just exactly how to catch their men when they need to.
Well, they're leaving it a bit late this time. They're getting inside 2 kilometres from the finish now. A new situation evolves. If they are caught, it means 3 small bonuses for the first 3 riders over the line. Could open up the time gaps in this race. And again, we could see a change in the leader's jersey. I think Peter Sagan immediately becomes the favourite for the big bonus as he won yesterday. He's a powerful boy, inch by inch. And we're looking now for the Kenda 1 kilometre bridge over the road. And they're going to be caught right on it, I think.
Well, Tony Martin, hats off to that man from Germany, the rider from HTC Columbia. He's ridden on the front end of this bike race for almost 200 kilometres here this afternoon. There is the catch, Phil. Those two riders have only just survived. We haven't yet got to the Kenda 1 kilometre to go banner, and still Tony Martin riding at the front. Third position there is Mickey Rogers on his wheel. It's Peter Sagan, the young rider from Slovakia. Behind him, it's Levi Leipheimer and the Radio Shack squad. And then just behind them, it's Dave Zabriskie.
Well, you have to feel sad there for Mark DeMar. He played a super card and he's fallen short by just a half a mile or 1 kilometre here. These boys are now turning. They'll get a sight of the finishing banner, but it is uphill. It has to be judged to perfection. Otherwise, they will lose.
finishing line, the finishing banner right in front of them, and it's still the control of HTC Colombia. They have proved today, Phil, finishing banner right in front of them, and it's still the control of HTC Colombia. They have proved today, Phil, why they are one of the great squads on the international circuit, because they've risen to the occasion. They've had the whole weight of the race upon their shoulders alone, and they've done a great job. But now, can Mickey Rogers finish it off for them? Can he remain in that yellow jersey, moving up the outside? It looks like Dave Zabriskie right on the shoulders of Mick Rogers.
Well, there's the long view from the finishing line now, and it does rise slightly uphill. They're wise to judge their sprint to the last possible minute, and is it going to be a desperate sprint? Now, we will watch the whereabouts here. We've still got Oscar Pujol on the black jersey of Cervelo, but now the move is across the road as Pujol tries to steal this one under the nose and take the win bonus, but it won't be a yellow jersey. I think he's done enough, Pujol, as he goes clear, but we've got to take our eyes to the race for the yellow jersey as they come for the line. Pujol has gone on the right of the road here, Paul, but nobody making a move on the left.
Now, Mickey Rogers is in first place at the front end of the main field. Locked onto his wheel is Levi Leipheimer. The infighting between the top men of the overall standings now may well give the advantage to the young man from Cervelo Test Team. His team management had said on this hilly stage he could be the man to create the surprise, and he's now looking at 400 meters to go. The acceleration is starting to come from Mick Rogers, but there's another move coming right down the left-hand side.
Well, watch out too for the green Herbalife leader's jersey on the right of the road now, and because that is the break by Peter Sagan. As Sagan comes on the right of the road, the yellow jersey of Michael Rogers is not being challenged by Zabriskie. Sagan gets it, and I think it was Rory Sutherland gets second place, but the third place to Michael Rogers. He will remain the leader of the tour. He will start last tomorrow in the Amgen Tour of California vital time trial, which is the penultimate day of this race. We have been treated to one of the best cycling stages we've seen in America ever.
That was an incredible finish there. Nice to see Peter Sagan finishing it off. He is a great bike rider at 20 years of age. Mick Rogers and the team, though, Phil, they did a great job this afternoon, HTC Colombia. There's the winner today, 20 years of age, two stages in Paris-Nice, one in the Tour of Romandie, and now number two here at the Amgen Tour of California. And he's inched his way a little bit closer to the top of the overall classification. Tomorrow, we have to see how this young man can time trial.
Exactly, and we will tomorrow, because that is the third win by stage Leaky Gas, and they lost the other winner today. Francesco Chicchi abandoned the race today. Just take a look at this again now. A sharp run on the right of the road gives the victory. Watch second, though. It's very important, this. Rory Sutherland found some legs to break through. He's in the shadow of Sagan. And I think he pushes the yellow jersey into third place, but he gets a small bonus, Mick Rogers, and that's what matters, which will keep him the lead. Win number five for Sagan.
Yeah, two in Paris-Nice, so one in the Tour of Romandie, Phil, and now two here at the Amgen Tour of California.
Yes, he's happy man.
No, he certainly is, and I can let him know that just around the corner from the finish line where he is here, there's a very nice pizzeria, so he can have a little taste of Italian food this evening. In fact, some of the Liquid Gas helpers were at the pizzeria last night, and they had a little takeaway, maybe to give them a flavor of Italy. Liquid Gas, this young man consolidating his lead in the points competition, consolidating his lead in the best young rider competition, and of course, more importantly maybe for him, getting himself a stage victory number two. But good job by Mickey Rogers. I'm pretty certain that Mickey Rogers there was in third place, and that will put him 4 seconds ahead of Dave Zabriskie and another 4 seconds ahead of Levi Leipheimer going into the individual time trial. There's confirmation. It was Rory Sutherland in second place, Rogers in third, Leipheimer fourth, Ryder Heiserdahl in fifth, and Phil Zajacek up there for his team right there in sixth, and he rides for Team Fly V Australia. And change in the overall standings is now that Mick Rogers with that time bonus, and again the explanation, the time bonus is you win for finishing in the first three places at the end of a stage.
Now all we've got to do is get Paul Sherwin to sharpen his pencil and tell me who's leading this race. I think it's no doubt it's got to be Michael Rogers, isn't it, Paul?
It's Michael Rogers by 4 seconds ahead of Dave Zabriskie and by 14 seconds. In fact, no, I've got it wrong there, because Peter Sagan will move over Levi Leipheimer into third slot.
Well, let's have a look, see if we can find out what's going on, because I think it was Sagan who won, Sutherland was second, Michael Rogers got third, Levi Leiper is in fourth place, so he just missed out on the bonuses. Radar Hazjadal is in third. And further down, I can tell you, Phil Zajicek got a good sixth place. Zabriskie crossed the line in eighth place. And Tommy Danielson finished in 10th place. So in the end, the Garmin boys slipped away a little bit.
Well, they did, but that's not so important. They kept their man, Dave Zabriskie, at the top end of the overall classification. Yes, he's lost 4 seconds to Michael Rogers because of that third place finish by the Australian. However, it could all get turned around completely and utterly tomorrow because we are looking at a 33-kilometer individual time trial. Now, there are three guys in this bike race, Phil. We've talked about them since the very first day who are extremely good at the individual time trial. Michael Rogers, Dave Zabriskie and Levi Leipheimer. Tomorrow they have to come out and play.
They do. Leipheimer will have slipped back a place today. Young Sagan has gone over him, but I think tomorrow it will swing advantage Levi Leipheimer, who we know is a proven great time trial rider. But Sagan again, he's showing he's very inspired. At the moment, Rogers leads this race by 4 seconds over Dave Zabriskie, by 9 seconds over Peter Sagan, 14 over Levi Leipheimer. Absolutely nothing in after a day like today. And Sutherland himself has got into the picture now. He's only 29 seconds off the top of the leaderboard. It really is anybody's race in the time trial tomorrow. And if it's a close finish tomorrow, it is going to then, the next day, is going to be a big showdown on the mountainous final stage over the Thousand Oaks. Just after 4 seconds to Zabriskie, it's nothing. Or 9 seconds to Sagan if you can ride a time trial. That is nothing over 32 kilometres or nearly 21 miles. Leipheimer, I don't think he'll be too unhappy about the situation at all tonight. Tommy Danielson continues to ride well. Jens Voigt, you know, if you look at the top nine riders in this race, you're looking at 35 seconds across the board. So we're going to see a super race tomorrow right down in the heart of one of the most famous cities in the world, home of the film stars, Los Angeles. And it's, oh, well, that's it's a blast from the past across the ocean right now, Paul, but it's a, I think he must have taken the sails off that and put the engine in. Look at the speed of it.
No, no, that's one of the pirate ships that hails from here. It's the Big Bear pirate ship by the name, and it's often used to take narrated tours around the lake here of Big Bear Lake, and it really is a great place. You can have a nice spot of lunch on there too if you like to.
Well,
I think they're just coming
what,
in now.
We've given them another story to talk about here when they next go out onto Big Bear Lake, because that was a tremendous bike race today. It really was. Everybody threw all that they had at the race and they couldn't crack each other. The result is that Mick Rogers is keeping his yellow jersey tonight, starts last in the time trial. Nothing in it. We're looking at a huge number of riders sitting at 35 seconds. They were at 31, but the bonuses have made a slight difference. They're back to 35 now. Any of them who can ride a time trial, which includes ninth placed overall Chris Horn at 35 seconds, Hazjadal, Brakjevic, Danielson, they could all be up there tomorrow night.
Phil, look at that, though. The United Healthcare team presented by Maxis is a local United States team. They've got two riders in the top six in the overall classification. Rory Sutherland with his second place today, moving up into fifth place. And Mark DeMar, after that incredible breakaway, is still holding on to sixth. Now, that is a great performance by that team.